So I'm going to talk about how we read Ramayana now in 2015 as 21st century people, though some of us, of course, claim our politics and our ideologies were created in the 20th century, mine certainly were. But I think it's also very important to think about how we read Ramayana in the times in which we now live, specifically in this country, in the city certainly. The city where I live has different tensions, but it is very, very important for us to reclaim a text that has been taken away from us. So how do we think about the Ramayana in our times? What can we find as 21st century individuals in a story that is just about 3,000 years old? Is there anything in it that can speak to us, anything in it that can draw us in to this ancient story rather than shut us out of it? What contemporary meaning can we find in a story about flying monkeys who speak Sanskrit and 10-headed demons that abduct women, in a story of boons and curses, in a story of obedient sons and submissive wives? Reasonable scholars believe that elements of the Rama story were in circulation as early as 500 BCE. But the earliest recorded version of the story that we have is Valmiki's Sanskrit version from about 300 BCE. The story of the exiled prince, his abducted wife, and the great war that he fought to win her back obviously captured the imagination of our cultures, and I say cultures in the plural, cultures over the centuries. We know this because the story of Rama appears in almost all our Indian languages. It appears among ruling elites and marginalized peoples. It appears among the Gons, among the Jains, among the Dalits, among women. Everyone has a response to the Ramayana. It seems that everyone talks back to the story that Valmiki composed. For example, Tulsidasa imbues the story with bhakti. His love for Rama as God drenches the entire text of the Manas. But Tulsi's anxiety about the violation of Sita as the goddess is so great that he makes sure that in Ramcharit Manas, she is replaced by a Chaya Sita in the forest before Ravana carries her away. Gamban writes some of Tamil's most exquisite poetry when he recreates the moment when Sita saw Rama, her bridegroom, for the first time as he entered the city of Mithila. Kirtibasa insists that the most important deity in his Bengali story of Rama is Monosha, the local snake goddess. But we don't only make insertions into the Rama story so that it becomes ours. Equally often, we talk back to the Ramayana in critical voices, asking questions, staking claims, challenging the story itself. I've been told many, a long time ago, somebody told me that in Eastern UP, there's a saying, don't marry your daughters to the men from Ayodhya, look how they treat their wives. 19th and 20th century women's songs in Telugu sympathize with Sita for the weak husband that she has been given. Jaina Ramayanas, the Pavam Charyu, which in Sanskrit is the Padma Charitam, in particular, Jain Ramayanas mock Hindus precisely for believing that monkeys can fly and that there can be a creature. Shall I just stand back? No. Okay. Okay. So Jain Ramayanas mock Hindus precisely for believing that monkeys can fly and that there can be a creature with 10 heads and 20 arms. The Padma Charitam offers rational explanations for these moments. As a monkey, Hanuman leaps so far and so high that he seems to be flying. Duh. Ravana wore a magnificent necklace of 9 polished gems in which his own handsome head was reflected 9 times, and so we think of him as being 10-headed. Buddhist Ramayanas see Rama and his brothers as bodhisattvas. Periyar, the founder of the Dravida self-respect movement in southern India and Tamil Nadu, read the Ramayana as the Aryan push into southern India, thereby seeing Ravana as the heroic and righteous but ultimately defeated king of the Dravida people. And there's that very famous instance, of course, which Ramanujan quotes in his seminal essay, 300 Ramayanas. He cites I'm sure everybody knows this, but I just love to tell it again. He cites the Adhyatmya Ramayana, when there's this this moment, you know, when Rama is going into the forest and he tells his brother and his mother that he's going, and then finally, of course, he tells his wife, and she says, but I'm going to come with you. And he's like, no, you can't come with me. And she says, but I want to. And this argument goes on, and he gives reasons why she should stay home, and she gives him reasons why she should come with him. And finally, in Adhyatmya Ramayana, Sita says to Rama, Rama, have you heard of any Ramayana in which Sita does not go with Rama to the forest? Yeah. So the text knows itself, the tradition knows itself, it talks to itself, it talks back to itself. And this is, so I want to be very clear about this one thing, that, you know, our engagement with the Ramayana has been over centuries. It's, we're not critical of it now because we're so cool in the 21st century, we suddenly have, you know, a whole new way of thinking about ourselves and the world. No, there's a long tradition of questioning the Ramayana, and questioning it not necessarily to discard it, most often questioning it to claim it for oneself again. So all this goes to show that somehow, whether in negative or in positive terms, this is a story that matters to us. This is a story that touches the deepest core of our being as Indians. We tell it over and over again because we need to get it right. We need it to make sense to us, wherever it is that we stand in time and space. And I have to apologize to Anjum, because he's Mr. Mahabharata, you know. We don't fight against the Mahabharata quite as much. We seem to like the questions and the answers that the Mahabharata provides. For there are not as many alternative readings or versions of the Mahabharata. You know, there are more stories, there are more local stories, there are more complex stories, but they're not fundamentally questioning stories. The central set of events in the Mahabharata and what they mean remains essentially the same. My larger point here is that we've been trying to find ourselves in the Ramayana for centuries, that this quest for contemporaneity is not because we now find the story conservative, outdated, and problematic. And as our forefathers and our foremothers have found that the Ramayana does speak to them, so too, we can find people and events and ideas in this story that make sense to us, that speak a metaphorical language that we understand. Often, however, what we seek and find in the Ramayana will be at variance with the dominant cultural narrative, particularly the narrative that is handed down to us by entrenched structures like hegemonic elites and the patriarchy, structures which have the most to lose should we find and act upon the meanings and significances that the Ramayana can show to us. And it is in this light, the light of an alternative narrative that the text itself contains, and I want to stress this, it's an alternative narrative, but it is contained within the same text, that I want to talk about Sita today. I should make it clear that the text that I'm referring to and working with is the Valmiki Ramayana, and there's a very particular kind of Sita that we can find in Valmiki, which we may or may not find in other language versions of Ramayana. Not only is Valmiki the oldest Rama story we have, it is one of the most open of all the tellings of Rama stories. It offers us more questions than it does answers. It allows us to think for ourselves about people and events. Of course, it is also true that this is the Ramayana that nobody actually reads. My translation of the Ramayana came out nearly 20 years ago, and lovely, all my friends, so sweet, you know, they bought it, and it's in the, you know, the first edition was very impressive. It was this black hardcover, and it's, you know, it's in everybody's bookshelf. Everywhere I go, it's like, hey, Cecilia, I have your book. You know, nobody's ever opened it. The spine is untouched. It looks like it's come out, like, of the shop, right? And so I say, like, you know, why haven't you read my book? And he said, I know the story, you know? And it's like, well, I'll get to that in a minute, right? So of course it is also true that this is the Ramayana that nobody actually reads, mainly because it's in Sanskrit, but also because we think we know the story. We think that the Ramayana that we know, the one that is closest to us in terms of language and culture, is the Valmiki Ramayana, or more specifically, actually, it is the Ramayana. Well, it's not, yeah? When I was translating Ramayana, which took a couple of years, you you meet people and people say, well, what do you do? And I thought I translate Ramayana, and you know, I thought that would be a start to a good conversation. It was just like people were like, and I said, well, the same thing, I know Ramayana. Why are you translating it? So many people have done it already. Who's going to read it? Everybody knows the story. So I was like, well, you know, I have a publishing contract. So I'm just going to do it. But then people, and I'll say, well, you know, I'm translating Valmiki. I know Valmiki. I said, okay, tell me a story. Tell me a story that is in the Valmiki Ramayana. And without exception, I was always told a story that was not in the Valmiki Ramayana. Shabari, for example, which is a story that we hold so dear, you know, in bhakti traditions, and you know, when we think in mainstream narratives and mainstream cultures, how little indigenous people show up in our lives and our stories. We say, no, Shabari. Everybody will say Shabari. Shabari is not in Valmiki. Shabari is not even in Kamba. In fact, Chaitanya is going to help you find out when Shabari first enters the Ramayana. The other story, of course, that everybody says, yeah, Lakshman Rekha. Guess what? That's not in Valmiki either. It's very, very, very late. So Valmiki remains, ironically, though it is the font of all Rama stories that we have in India, it remains, to us moderns, it remains the text that we know least. Just as Rama is given to us as the Maryada Purushottama, the ideal man, so we are told to think of Sita as an ideal for us as Indian women. We should emulate her unquestioning devotion to her husband as she followed him into the forest, her forbearance and courage when she was in captivity, her determination to prove herself innocent when she's accused of infidelity, and her submission to her second banishment into the forest when she is pregnant. There is much here to admire in Sita and the way she handles the trials and tribulations of her life. But for some of us, especially for women, there is equally much to question and to strive against. We must remember that this ideal of Sita has been created for us and not necessarily by us. It is a picture that we have been given rather than a picture that we have painted. It is a mirror that reflects the creators and not the created. But what if we sought Sita for ourselves, as so many have done before us? Whom would we find? So what I want to do tonight, rather than create our own Sita in opposition to the one that has been handed down to us over the centuries, the one that troubles us so, let's look for Sita to what she says in her own voice in the Valmiki Ramayana. I'm going to work with episodes that we all know well, that are central to our culture's understanding of the Ramayana, and of course, obviously, central to our understanding of Sita as well. So I'm going to read when Rama tells her that he's going to go into the forest without her. This is not the Adhyatmi Ramayana, this is Valmiki, so it'll be rather more serious. Dearest wife, says Rama, I'm going to the forest, but you, my queen, you must stay here and live in such a way that no one can criticize you. This is what I want you to do. Sita was a soft-spoken person who was worthy of affection and respect. But now she spoke to her husband with an anger that arose from her love for him. My mother and father taught me how to behave in various situations. I need no advice about what I should do now. I shall live in the forest as happily as I lived in my father's house, with not a care in the world, concerned only with my loyalty to my husband. I shall find joy in the fragrant flowering forest as I care for you and I live the life of an ascetic. And then he persuades her again, you know, this is not a great place for you to be. And she says, excuse me. Despite Sita's many pleas, Rama refused to change his mind. She wept hot tears that bathed the earth. Rama tried how to console her, but she was lost in her grief. Slowly, though, Sita grew angry and said indignantly to Rama, how did my father, the king of Mithila and the lord of the Videhas, get you, a woman disguised as a man, for a son-in-law? The world is wrong when they say that there is no one greater than Rama, who blazes like the sun. What could possibly have made you so depressed and frightened that you wish to leave me here, I, who have no other refuge, I have never even thought about another man, unlike other women who bring shame on their families. Under no pressure at all, Rama, you have decided to leave your wife with others, the wife you married as a young virgin girl and who has lived with you for so long. You cannot go to the forest without me. I will go with you wherever you go, whether to the forest, to perform austerities, or to heaven. And then he says, okay, you can come. I'm going to read another passage from Dandaka, which is, as you know, the great wilderness where really all the bad things happen, starting with the mutilation of Shurpanakha and then the magical deer and the abduction of Sita and the killing of Jatayu. So it is really the heart of the Ramayana, what happens in the Dandaka forest. But this is a place where we hear something very unexpected. This is just before the encounter with Shurpanakha. And Sita says, Sita spoke gently to her husband. You are a man of great deeds, and when you consider the matter carefully, I'm sure you will see that dharma is very subtle. There are three major weaknesses that arise from desire. One is telling lies. The other two are much worse. One is lusting after another man's wife, and the other is cruelty without a justified cause for hostility. You have never lied, Rama, nor will you ever do so. You do not covet the wives of others, and you have not acted in violation of dharma. These things would only be done by a man who has no control over his senses, but I know that you are perfectly disciplined. But the third weakness which men succumb to because of their passions, the inflicting of violence and cruelty upon other beings without enmity or reason, that weakness appears to be present in you now. You have promised to kill the Rakshasas in combat in order to protect the sages who live in the Dandaka forest. This has brought you and your brother to the forest armed with your bows and arrows. Now that you are here with your brother and both of you are armed, you shall see many forest creatures. Inevitably, you will be tempted to use your arrows. Like dry fuel bursts into flame when it is near a fire, so too a Kshatriya's passions are ignited when he has a bow at hand. A Kshatriya should use his bow in the forest only to protect the oppressed. What a difference there is between the life of weapons and that of the forest, between the vows of a Kshatriya and those of an ascetic. We must learn to respect the code of behavior of the world we now inhabit. Here, the mind is perverted by extreme proximity to weapons. You can return to the code of the Kshatriyas when we go back to Ayodhya. And so he listens to her and he says, yeah, well, thank you, but you know what, Sita, you're just a woman. And then, of course, you know, well, we'll get to that in a bit. I want to read something now which astounded me, absolutely astounded me, when I read it for the first time. And I think it made me so uncomfortable that I forgot about it for many years. And then I've recently come back to it, and I feel that I need to knit this into a larger narrative, not simply of Sita, but of the Ramayana. This is when Hanuman is in Lanka. He's found Sita already. He's determined to, you know, he suggests that he should take her back, and she's like, I don't think that's such a good idea. You know, you're a monkey, I might fall off your back. And he's like, no, but I'm Hanuman. But what she, Rama, of course, has sent his signet ring for Sita, so he gives her the signet ring, and he takes her to Ramani, yeah, as proof. That he has met her. And so Hanuman says, but since you cannot come with me, blameless lady, give me a token by which Rama will know that I have met you. Sita, who was like a daughter of the gods, replied softly, her voice broken by her tears. The best token that I can give you is this message. Say to my beloved Rama, and she says, earlier when we lived on the northeastern slope of the Chitrakuta mountain, in the region where the Mandakini flows, near the settlements of the holy ascetics, The area was filled with flowering trees and beautiful plants. One day, when my body was still wet from my bath, you fell asleep with your head in my lap. A crow carrying a piece of meat in its beak began to attack me, and I tried to ward it off with clods of earth. The bird clung to me with its vicious claws and began to tear at the flesh it carried. I was angry with the bird and drew off my girdle, but my clothes slipped off, and at that very moment you woke and saw me. You began to laugh, and I was terribly embarrassed. I hid in your arms to get away from the crow, and though I was still angry, I was mollified by your laughter. You wiped the tears from my eyes and my face, and then hissing like an angry serpent, you said, "Lady with the thighs like an elephant's trunk, who has dared strike you on the breast? You looked around and you saw the crow with its bloody claws. But the bird was the best of all creatures that can fly. He was one of Indra's sons, and with the speed of the wind, he entered the earth. You made a terrible decision. You took a blade of grass and invoked Brahma's weapon. The blazing blade flew towards the bird, following him through the air and everywhere as he tried to look for protection. The bird was renounced by his father and by all the holy sages. Finally, when he had traveled through the three worlds, the bird came to you for refuge. You protected him with compassion, even though he deserved death. But you could not recall the weapon once it had been invoked, and so you injured the crow's right eye. The crow thanked you and honored you and then flew back to its home. Lord of the earth, you would use the Brahma weapon against a lowly crow for my sake. How can you tolerate my being abducted by another creature? I have heard about your benevolence and your righteousness. Be compassionate to me and let me live in hope. You are brave and loyal and strong, as deep as the ocean and equanimous in all situations. You are skilled in the use of all weapons. Why do you not use them against these vile Rakshasas?" said Sita. So that's the story that she sends back with Hanuman. And of course, it's a story that only she and Rama can know. And of course, Crow, who's blind. And one of the reasons this has always astounded me is because we don't think about the Ramayana as a text of sensuality. We don't think that Rama and Sita have actually had a tender relationship. We think of them as exemplars. We think of them as public people. And we forget that they actually had a lot of time in the forest where they didn't have to perform their royal duties. So they had a chance, really, to get to know each other to experience a tenderness which is obviously quite unique, and I'll get to that a little bit more later. And I'm going to jump to the Agni Pariksha, which happens in Lanka. The battle has been won, Ravana has been defeated, Rama hasn't seen Sita for God knows how long, at least a year, possibly more. She has spent all her time doing nothing but think of him. He's been busy. He's been, you know, getting together allies. He's fought this terrible war. And Sita is expecting that Rama will want to meet her, and to meet her in private, but that's not the case. He asks Hanuman to go to Sita and say, come out, yeah, come onto the battlefield and see Rama there. He says to Vibhishana, who's the second person to get Sita, Rama says, why are you going against my wishes and treating these people so harshly? Vibhishana is moving back all the monkeys and bears and Rakshasas. Stop it immediately. These are my people. A woman's behavior is what protects her modesty. Not a home, nor fine clothes, nor high walls, or honors such as these. Women can be seen in public in times of calamities and emergencies, in times of war, at their own weddings and at religious rituals. A war has just been fought on Sita's account. She faces a crisis in her life. There is nothing wrong if she's seen in public, especially in my presence. Bring Sita here quickly, Vibhishana. Let her see me, surrounded by all my friends. Deeply embarrassed and shrinking into herself, Sita approached her husband, followed by Vibhishana. And then he says to her, she gazed at her beloved husband, who was like a god to her, and her face lit up with love, pleasure, and wonder. Her weariness and sorrow fell away the moment she saw her husband's moon-bright face, which she had not seen for so long. Rama looked at Sita standing meekly by his side and gave vent to the anger in his heart. I have killed the enemy, my dear, and I have won you back. In doing so, I have displayed the courage expected of me. I have avenged the insult, and it no longer bothers me. I have destroyed the enemy and the disgrace together. I have displayed my prowess and achieved my goals. I have kept my promises. Now I am free. You were carried off by a restless Rakshasa while you were alone with no one to protect you. I, a mere mortal, have redressed that wrong decreed by fate. I have done my duty by rescuing you from the enemy and avenging the insult to myself. You should know that this war, which was won by the heroic efforts of my friends, was not fought for your sake. I did it to vindicate my honor and to save my noble family from disgrace. I have terrible suspicions about your character and conduct, Sita. The sight of you is as painful to me as a lamp to a man with diseased eyes. You are free to go wherever you want. The world is open to you. I have no more use for you, Sita. Well, it's not over. How can a man born into a noble family lovingly take back a woman who has lived in the house of a strange man? I am proud of my noble lineage. How can I take you back when Ravana has touched you and when you have lived under his lustful gaze? I'm saying this to you after a great deal of deliberation. Go to Lakshmana or Bharata or to anyone else who pleases you. Go to Sugriva, the king of the monkeys, or to Vibhishana, the king of the Rakshasas. Go wherever you want. Sita could not believe the cruel words her husband had spoken to her after their long separation. She hung her head in shame at being spoken to like that in public. She seemed to shrink into herself, weeping at the arrow-sharp words that had pierced her heart. But she wiped the tears that streamed down her face and she said, "How could you say such things to me, the kind of things a low, common man would say to his woman? I'm not what you think I am, hero. I swear to this on my virtue. You judge all women by the conduct of a few. You should know better than to reject me like this. If my body was touched by another man, it was not because I wanted it. Destiny must bear responsibility for that. My heart, the only thing I could control, was always with you. What could I do about the other parts of my body that were subject to the will of others? But you have surrendered to your anger and acted like a common man, and you have treated me like a low and vulgar woman. You have not considered that I am the daughter of Janaka, that I was born from the earth. Nor did you consider the fact that my conduct has always been impeccable. The fact that we are married and that I'm devoted to you has been of no consequence at all." And then she turns to Lakshmana and she says, "Build a fire and I will prove my... I'll prove that I've been chaste." And then they come back. Rama is restored as he becomes the king of Ayodhya, and we're expecting a happily ever after ending. Everything is where it should be. Everything is in place. Everybody's happy. Sita's pregnant, and. Then there is this unfortunate incident where Rama hears that people are gossiping about the virtue of his wife, and so he sends her into the forest again, and he sends her into the forest under false pretenses. He says to Lakshmana, "You know, she's been dying to go back and visit her friends who are the wives of the sages, so tell her that you're taking her on a picnic and leave her there." And so Lakshmana does that. Eventually, Lakshmana tells her he has to leave her there and he's going to go back. And she says, how could the king have renounced me when I have always been so good and virtuous? I even lived in the forest and bore all kinds of hardships because I have always served at Rama's feet. How can I live in a hermitage now, separated from all the people that I love? Who can I talk to about this terrible grief that I must bear? What shall I say to the sages when they ask me what I did wrong? What reason can I give for the king forsaking me? And then she says, do as you're told, Lakshmana, abandon me. You must obey the king, but listen to what I have to say. Bow to all my mothers-in-law and touch their feet. Give them my greetings. Give them and the king my best wishes for their welfare, and then tell the king, always treat your subjects as you would your own brothers. That is the highest dharma, and it will earn you incomparable fame and glory. I care nothing for this corporeal body of mine. You should do whatever it takes to prevent the people from gossiping. And Lakshmana takes that message back to the king. And then the very last time we see Sita is when she's called to the great sacrifice and she's asked to prove her chastity yet again, because, you know, after all, the Agni Pariksha was in Lanka and it was only seen by monkeys and bears and rakshasas, and the people of Ayodhya need to be reassured that their queen is chaste and pure. So Rama asks for her to come back, and and she comes back with Valmiki, and he says, Sita has already declared her innocence before the gods, and I abandoned her even though I knew she was innocent because I feared a scandal. You must forgive me for that. I also know that the twin boys are my sons. When Sita proves her innocence before the world, I shall be able to love her again. And then she comes and, you know, she doesn't look at him, right? And realizing that Rama wanted Sita to prove herself, all the gods arrived there, led by Brahma. The heavenly and celestial beings came with them. Just then, Vayu released a gentle breeze, redolent with divine perfumes. As it wafted through the assembly, it made everyone calm and happy. The people who had come from other countries marveled at this, thinking that such a wondrous thing could only have happened a long time ago, in the Krita Yuga. Everybody watched as Sita, wearing an ochre robe, joined her palms. Her head was bowed, and she kept her eyes on the ground. And in her mind, she says, if I have never thought about any other man but Rama, let the goddess Madhavi create a chasm for me. As soon as she had finished speaking, a truly wondrous event occurred. A splendid celestial throne appeared from within the earth, and she is taken away back to her mother. So, and we can choose to know Sita through her own words. When we're told to think of Sita as an ideal, this is the woman that I think of, this woman that has appeared in these six or seven places where she speaks for herself. For all that she expresses the rhetoric of the good and obedient wife, whose destiny is entwined with that of her husband, she also shames Rama into taking her with him at the very beginning, right? When she says, I will go with you to the forest. She reminds him in no uncertain terms that her parents have taught her well about how she should behave. She calls him a coward who is unable to protect her. She calls him a woman disguised as a man. These are harsh words and strong ideas. This is a woman who makes her own decisions and far prefers the vicissitudes of a forest exile to a life in the palace and under the care of her brother-in-law, whom Rama has told her not to displease. But it is the speech about violence and the carrying of weapons in the forest that is truly remarkable. Perhaps this is the only time that Sita speaks as a person in her own right, not as a wife, not as a daughter-in-law, or a sister-in-law, not even as a queen-in-waiting. She is against gratuitous violence. She is also against preemptive violence. She is worried that Rama will be persuaded to use his weapons not only by the threat and suspicion of danger, but by the values that he has been taught to uphold. She worries about harming the innocent. She warns Rama against taking on the hostility of others. Sita speaks here as a woman more sensitive to context than the man she is with when she tells him that he can be a Kshatriya again when he returns to Ayodhya, that his actions in the forest may not be appropriate to the place in which they find themselves. Rama, to his detriment, ignores Sita's concerns and embarks on a course of action that leads eventually to the permanent loss of his wife. This is also the only speech in the entire text against violence, and it is a speech buried in perhaps the most violent book in the epic, the Aranyakanda. The sojourn in the Dandaka forest is littered with violent incidents, the mutilation of Shurpanakha, the decimation of Kara and Dushana, the killing of the golden deer, Sita's abduction, and the bloody death of Jatayu. Surely it is no accident that Sita says this and points to men's weaknesses just before all the violence in the story, a consequence of the very weaknesses she mentions, is unleashed. In the incident where she gives the story to Hanuman, it is an entirely different aspect of Sita that is revealed in the story that she gives Hanuman to take back to Rama. It is interesting that apart from giving him a physical token, her Chudamani, by which she will be recognized, she gives her messenger something even more intimate, a story that only she and Rama can know. It is a beautiful story, one that reminds us that Sita and Rama did have a relationship of tenderness and romance and sensuality, at least in the forest. It is also poignant that her thoughts of her husband when she is in captivity are thoughts of his physicality. Much like Rama's lament when he comes back from chasing the magic deer to find his beloved missing. How sweet and how reassuring it is to know that these exemplars of our culture also desired each other physically, that their memories of each other are bodily as well as cerebral. But of all the astounding moments in the Ramayana, perhaps the most astounding of all is when Rama chooses to meet his beloved wife, a woman that he has pined and grieved for during their separation, in public. There is no tenderness here, no intimate reunion in a quiet place away from the carnage of battle. There is only the growing brutality of Rama's march towards kingship. Rama's words to Sita are particularly harsh. He tells her to go to his brothers, to a monkey, even to a Rakshasa. Sita's response is pained, but dignified. At times, her words drip with contempt. Again, we hear an echo of what Sita had said to Rama when he wanted to leave her behind in the palace 14 years before. She reminds him of his duties towards his wife, of how he could be a better man, of what he owes her as a husband. She points to the one dharma that Rama is unable or unwilling to accept, his dharma as a husband, his obligations to her. Yet again, we see her courage. The first time she was willing to walk beside him in the forest, this time she is ready to walk into the fire to prove herself and her devotion to him. Further, she asks Lakshmana to build the fire, not wanting even this gesture from the man who has chosen to doubt her and to humiliate her in public. And look at what Sita says to Lakshmana, who once again finds himself doing the things that his elder brother cannot. Her message to Rama, when she's exiled a second time, her message to Rama could be seen as a dutiful acceptance of what has happened to her, or rather, what has been done to her. On the other hand, it's perfectly possible, if one wants to see this message as enormously sarcastic, asking Rama at the very end to do whatever it takes to stop people from gossiping. Her words tell us that she knows Rama has placed his obligations as a monarch over any obligation that he has to her as her husband, which is exactly what she says to him before the Agni Pariksha in Lanka, and as we have seen, before they leave together for the forest. If we choose, we can see Sita, who has strong opinions about conjugal duties. We can see a Sita, who has strong opinions about conjugal duties. She has been steadfast in all that she has had to do as a wife, so she criticizes her husband for not being the same in his commitment to her. Sita's second public trial is in Ayodhya, at Rama's great Ashwamedha sacrifice, before kings and gods and sages, and before her own sons. What she says here is completely unexpected. she asks that if she has been chaste, that she be taken away. Here is a woman who has had enough of being separated from her husband, enough of the suspicions about her character, enough of the endless public humiliations, and enough of her husband's duties that take him further away from her. And I want to read just a little bit from, do I have another 5 minutes? Sorry, I should have marked this before, but... I'm going to read just a little bit from this book called Lost Loves, where I read the Ramayana primarily as a love story. And I talk about this last incident where she chooses to go away. Sita finds it in herself to leave Rama because she has ceased to love him. More accurately, she cannot love the man that Rama has chosen to become. Whether it is because he has embraced the violence she begged him to reject when they were in the forest, or because he has placed his public honor before his personal truth, or because his honor and his truth have become one and the same thing. Perhaps the love he had for her has itself changed. It has become the love a king has for his consort, rather than the transformative love that two human beings can have for each other. Sita sustained herself through her captivity by keeping her mind on Rama, holding close the idea of a man she loved and who loved her, a love that fed on separation as much as it was nourished by togetherness. Sita had to remain constant, but Rama's experiences demanded that he cast aside his new ideas and hopes and forge a self that would be up to the challenges before him. The Rama that Sita meets at the end of the war is not the man she had stored in her heart. Her idea of Rama, so carefully nurtured and cherished during their first separation, did not match the reality she was now faced with. At the second reunion, she makes the choice to leave him, a choice made somewhat easier by the fact that she is leaving not the man she loved, she is leaving the king of Kosala, the ruler of Ayodhya. We are used to thinking of Sita as someone who deserves our pity and our sympathy, a woman buffeted by the storms of circumstance. First, the innocent object of Ravana's desire, then the equally innocent victim of her royal husband's honor, and ultimately the abandoned wife. What we fail to see is Sita's courage and defiance in her final act on earth when she refuses to live with a continuing falsehood. It could be that she held her dreams too closely, that she did not grow into the life that lay ahead of her as she proved unwilling to bow to the dictates of being Rama's queen. Perhaps she could have done more to understand the man she had loved so wholeheartedly, who surely deserved more than that final disdainful dismissal. But the Ramayana is a story about love, about how love can sustain us, how it must live in the shadow of public lives and commitments, how it can become the basis of personal truths that need to be lived out. While Rama chooses to place his love in the penumbra of his luminous public life, Sita chooses to place her love squarely in the glare of Rama's shining glory. As it turns out, neither the shadowed love nor the illuminated love was able to survive. The tragedy of the Ramayana is not simply that there is no happy ending, with Rama and Sita finally reunited. Sita disappears into the earth, and Rama is left to his private grief in the company of his young sons. The greater tragedy of the Ramayana is the death of their love for each other, a love which cannot renew itself in the changed circumstances of their lives. For all that Rama may still feel for his gentle wife, he cannot or will not express those feelings after the war and their return to Ayodhya. For all that Sita has loved her husband during the trials and tribulations of the exile, that love could not sustain itself when Rama banished her to the forest for a second time. Sita's heartbroken departure can be seen as a rejection of a life made less by the absence of love, as an act of personal truth and public courage. Rama is left with the public truth and little else. So when we're told to think about Sita as an ideal for all of us, this is the Sita that I think of, a woman who spoke for herself and ultimately took charge of her own destiny. She is not the Sita that patriarchal structures want to see or to celebrate, but she is the Sita that we can find if we look for her. And there can be no better reason to read Ramayana, to read 300 Ramayanas, because the better we know the story, the more likely the story is to speak to us in 2015. The story of Rama has always been rich and it has always been generous. It expands to include anyone who seeks to find meaning in it. The problem is that it is our spirit that does not match the wealth and openness of the text. It is our smallness of heart and our narrowness of vision that lets some people in and lets other people out. The story speaks in many voices. It is we who have become deaf.
I was wondering if there's any mention of Ram's growing or changing emotions as he, once Sita's left, how does he go from loving her to becoming maybe a jealous, despairing kind of guy, which makes him so angry towards her when he finally gets her?
When Sita leaves him, it's the Uttarakhanda, which I'm actually working on right now. And in the Uttarakhanda, Rama is terrifyingly opaque. He has no emotions at all. In fact, the one emotion that he does have is when he hears the gossip about her, he's distraught. And he calls his brothers and he says, "Don't argue with me. I know you're not going to like what I'm going to do, but this is what I'm going to do. And kings do not like people who argue with them, so please just do what I'm saying." At that point, Rama is surrounded by a coterie of Brahmins, Agastya, Vasishtha, of course. And they keep telling him these stories about how great he is and about how great his family is. And when Sita goes away, he listens to some more stories, and eventually Kala comes to him and says it's time to go, and so he makes preparations for his final samadhi, and that's it, really. So we have no access to who Rama is at that point and what he might be thinking. But we also know that the Uttarakhanda and the Balakhanda were written much later. We treat them as parts of a text that we call Valmiki, but in fact they are... So the Rama of the Uttarakhanda, there's a reason why he's different from the Rama of the main text.
Just one, I was wondering, is the distrust of Rama towards Sita, and I'm just asking you about this, could it also be from the, the way there's a natural distrust for women per se, the way Kaikeyi or his mothers and all behave with him, and he doesn't trust women as, general species, and that's, never trust them. Is that some kind of patriarchal or, misogynist view that...
Oh, absolutely, 100%. I mean, yeah, I don't think that justifies his distrust for her. It kind of makes it worse because it comes out of an ideology rather than an experience. Yeah, sure. And there's also Ahalya. The story of Ahalya is told more than once in Valmiki Ramayana, and that's about the same concern. What are conjugal boundaries and when do they get broken and what are the consequences of transgressing that,
I've read neither the Valmiki nor the Tulsi Ramayana. So this question comes from someone who will now read the Valmiki Ramayana.
Hopefully my translation.
Yours. is the Tulsi Ramayana Ramcharit Manas very different in its depiction of Sita? Is there a big departure in does he sort of change completely the figure of Sita?
He does, what happens is he changes the figure of Rama in Tulsi Ramayana. Like so many other every other Ramayana that came after Valmiki, Rama is always God. And if he's God, if Rama is God, then the people around him have to change as well. So Sita is the goddess. And once she becomes the goddess, then there are certain things that you cannot do. For example, Ravana cannot have touched her. So then we have this Chaya Sita thing. In Kamba Ramayana, in the Tamil Ramayana, there's the same problem. She is the goddess again. So, but what Kamba Ramayana, what Kamban does is that Ravana doesn't touch her. He picks up the earth around her feet and carries her away like that. So in a sense, he's also violating her mother, you know, by digging up the earth upon which she's standing. Yeah, it is a substantially... every Ramayana is different from Valmiki's. Every Ramayana is imbued not only with its own its local cultures, but also with perspectives and with positions. And it must be so, because these texts are composed in history. They're composed in historical moments. So what was happening in 16th century India, Northern India, obviously had some kind of impact on what Tulsi was thinking and writing, and what was happening in 11th century, what we now call Tamil Nadu, obviously had some kind of an impact on Kamban. And I think that's just marvelous, you know, that we are watching actually as we read multiple Ramayanas, from Valmiki to, you know, Samhita Arni's Sitana, which came out last year, we're actually seeing the growth and development of a great religious tradition. We're seeing how a religion is modifying itself to always be current, to always be attractive, and I think that's just fantastic, you know. We're able to see that in Hinduism in ways that we can't see with very many other religions, that this is a vibrant, throbbing, responsive energy, really, yeah.
There have been a few textual information that I've read in the recent past where it says that Sita was the daughter of Ravana and not Sri, and Ravana apparently didn't like Ram, and hence he just took her back, because, you know, he didn't like her to be in the Vanvas and spend her life in exile and etc. So how far do we believe in the authenticity of informations like this floating around in various textual forms or various writers?
I think precisely what you just said is precisely the problem. Where did you get this information? Yeah, what is this text that you're referring to? Texts are authenticated by themselves, not by other people. So, you know, okay, yeah, so Ravana, she was a daughter, where did you get that? Why would you even imagine that it is something that you would like to relate to the Ramayana that we know? You're free to do that, but what is your textual source? Or it doesn't even have to be a textual source anymore. Oh, I saw it on TV. Arey, my auntie said. Yeah, but you know that when you say my auntie said, and, you know, I saw it on TV, already the truth value of both those things is substantially different, even though your auntie is probably right and what you see on TV is wrong, but that's not the point, right? So,
You know, Ramayana is the tale of Ram, and when the author wrote Ramayana, probably he had Ram as a hero in his mind, and he continues to be the hero in his mind. But the way you've been mentioning about the way Sita saw Ram, Ram doesn't really come across as a hero. Now, in the way the author wrote it, did he really have it in mind to paint the hero as not such a strong man? I'm just trying to understand that.
Yeah, that's a very good point, actually, because this Valmiki is the only author for whom we have no independent historical evidence, right? In fact, many of us believe that Valmiki is a construct, that he's an attribution. It's very difficult to think about a text without an author. We don't take a text without an author that seriously. So every single writer, after every single teller of the Rama story, after Valmiki, is a historical person. Right? And Rama is completely heroic in those texts. So when we have a historical man writing the story of Rama, Rama is heroic. The Valmiki text is much more amorphous. We don't quite know how it congealed, how it came together, it has layers from many centuries. It seems to have the inputs of many minds, much like the Mahabharata. So it's possible that, you know, that you can have a stronger Sita in the Ramayana because it wasn't a single intelligence that was creating that text. Whereas, you know, if you have Kamban or you have Kirtivasa or whoever, they say, no. You know, there is one center and that center is Rama.
After all that you said about Rama's digressions, then how come he is still the Maryada Purushottam?
Or is he to you?
No,
well, then there you are. That's sufficient. He's not the Malayala Purushottama to many of us. So, and you can see why some kind of people would want him to be the Malayala Purushottama. It's not about him as much as it's about us. You know, it's about how to put us in our place. And I think you know, we would. I think it's the idea of Mariyada Purushottama is really up now for negotiation. It is a contested idea that there should be such a thing at all, that this person should be it. And I think that's just fantastic that we are asking questions that are not necessarily hostile questions. You know, a question is not necessarily a challenge. It is not necessarily an act of hostility. Sometimes it's just a genuine curiosity, like, how do I think about this? So I think it's a good idea to question that. So.
Ma'am, you told that Sita is the woman of self-respect. Sita is the woman of self-respect. Then why she obey the every order given by the Ram? Because she loves her too much. Otherwise, she respect him.
I think she loves him. I think that's a very big part of why. As you say, she obeys him. I don't think she obeys him necessarily. I think every time he wants to do something, she questions him about it. She asks him about it. Yeah, and I think she asks him not simply to reassure herself, but also I think to indicate to him that he needs to think a little bit more carefully about what he's asking her to do. I think I have trouble with the word that she obeys him. I think she chooses to do some of the things he wants her to do, not all of them. So that obey is now for me a very old-fashioned word in terms of how we think about men and women together. You know.
I have a question. I have two questions actually.
One will do.
Both are related to logic. One is about Hanuman wanting to carry Sita back. No, there's nothing wrong with that. Especially when he himself says that I am like a son to you. There's nothing wrong with the son carrying a mother figure back. So what is the analysis on that, number one? Number two is when a woman jumps into fire, any woman, she's born.
Oh, yeah, we're doing it constantly, right?
Yeah. So how do you explain that entire Agni Pariksha thing? These two are, they never sit right with the logic.
I think when we read a text as complex as Ramayana, I think one of the first things we have to do is to surrender to the logic of the text. Great stories have narrative logic. They make sense. They're complete in their own way. In Valmiki Ramayana, and I don't know any other Ramayana that well, in Valmiki Ramayana, there's a 3-4 page discussion between Hanuman and Sita, and he's saying, let me carry you. And she says, no, you'll drop me. He's saying, but I didn't drop you before. Blah, blah, blah. And eventually he talks himself out of carrying her because he said, you know what, in the end, I'm a monkey. I'm full of kapitvam. Yeah, my monkey nature made me suggest this, and of course I'm wrong. Yeah. As for the logic of Agni Pariksha, I mean, that defeats me completely. But I want to say this other thing also, that, you know, that in another one of my favorite Sita moments, which actually I should include in this, is, you know, Rama and Lakshmana, we all meet Hanuman at the same time. They've just, you know, they've left Gandaka, they're in Kishkinda, they've been told, go to meet Sugriva. And suddenly this monkey shows up, he's speaking Sanskrit. He's dressed like a bhikshu, then he flies. Nobody's worried. Nobody's concerned. Nobody's in fact, Lakshmana said, what lovely Sanskrit you speak, right? Right? Now, at this point in the text, we are just like, okay, fine, there's a monkey, he speaks Sanskrit, he flies. When Hanuman, when he sees Sita, when he finds her in the Ashoka Vana, he's very, very anxious. And he says, how do I convince her that I'm a friend? Because she's been surrounded by Rakshasis. She probably thinks it's a Rakshasa in disguise. She's not going to trust me. She's so frightened. She's so sad, right? And so he says, okay, I'll sit up in the tree and I will tell her about the virtues of Rama. Then she will feel relaxed, right? So he's sitting up in the tree and he starts saying how lovely Rama is. And Sita is like, you know, shaken out of her sadness. And, you know, she looks up and she sees this monkey and she says, a
talking monkey? That's ridiculous. This cannot be true. I must be dreaming. She said, but no, I can't be dreaming, because if I was dreaming, it would mean I'm asleep. But I haven't been sleeping because I'm so sad. And she said, but this is impossible. There cannot be a talking monkey. Right? Halfway into Hanuman's adventure, somebody says, hey guy, that monkey is talking. This is not possible. Right? That monkey is talking Sanskrit. This is even less possible. Right? So the text will show that it knows what it's doing. Right? The text is like, okay, I gave you a flying monkey, I'm going to explain it. You know, just leave it for a bit, right? And then Sita, of all people, is the one who calls the bluff, who really says the emperor has no clothes. Right? Agni Pariksha, I've got nothing to say about that. I mean, I can't imagine that anybody has, actually. So.
Well, personally, thank you for really such a lovely, stimulating address. I just wanted to ask you, how do you read that final moment, a decision which was long in coming, and she does take it to leave? How do you reconcile that when she's leaving her two sons? Is there any commentary on that or interpretation that she's willing to assert herself, and yet what is their fate? Knowing him as she does now, Ram, she's willing for them to be reared by such a man.
I think that's exactly the point. That is exactly the point, that Rama has always wanted his sons, and they're going to become like him. And there is no place for her. And that's another reason why she's able to go. That it was, and you know, of course, his sons are returned to him at this massive sacrifice where everybody's there. And so it's not simply legitimizing the sons for Rama, is legitimizing the future rulers of Ayodhya, of the Ikshvaku clan. So I think it's precisely that. She's like, this is not a place for a woman. These guys have got something worked out and they don't need me, not even her children. You know, I mean, they're 12 or something like that. So, but yeah, I remember once when I was teaching this to American undergraduates, and I was sort of making the same point about how, you know, she leaves, and this young woman just got so agitated. She was like, she's a bad mommy. And I was like, first of all, it's a little hard for me to say bad mommy, you know, when I think of Sita. But she just had this thing that, no, she's abandoned her children. There's no reason this woman should be treated as a goddess. There's no reason this woman needs to be idealized. That there's no way that an action like that can be integrated in any kind of positive response to Sita.
We have been discussing the personalities in Ramayana, the characteristics of Sita and Ram. And midway, we came to the strange points in Ramayana, as if how a monkey can speak in Sanskrit. I think all these are symbolism in Ramayana. And there is a lot in Valmiki's text itself to interpret this symbolism. Jaise Sita poochti hai Hanuman se, ki is Bharat going to send his army to free me? अब ये सीधा पूछती है तो हम भी पूछ सकते हैं कि सीता को छुड़ाने के लिए अयोध्या से सेना क्यों नहीं आई. तो देर इज अ सिंबॉलिज्म इन टेक्स्ट इटसेल्फ एंड वी हैव टू डिकोड इट. देर इज अ लॉट ऑफ सिंबॉलिज्म. जैसे इन बालकांडा ब्रह्मदेव रिक्वेस्ट विष्णु अवतार ले लो चार पुत्रों के रूप में, कौशल्या कैकेयी वगैरह रानियों के वंश के नाते. But when it comes to other goddesses and other gods, उनके लिए बताता है कि वानरी के गर्भ से जन्म लो, अश्वनी के जन्म से गर्भ से जन्म लो. तो ये जो चेंज है ये भी एक सिंबॉलिज्म है. और एक जगह पे वाल्मीकि ने ऐसे बता, संपादि के संवाद में आता है कि नागों के लिए क्रोध भाव स्वाभाविक है, मृगों के लिए भय भाव स्वाभाविक है, गंधर्वों के लिए काम भाव स्वाभाविक है. तो ये भी एक सिंबॉलिज्म है. मैं समझता हूँ कि ये सिंबॉलिज्म यदि डिकोड करे तो उसमें जो अद्भुतता है, रोमापाद की कथा में अद्भुतता है कि जैसे ऋष्यशृंग उसके राज में प्रवेश करता है तो बारिश शुरू हो जाती है. तो ये सभी सिंबॉलिज्म्स डिकोड करनी चाहिए. मैंने एक आपके पास किताब दी है इन विच आई हैव ट्राइड टू डिकोड ऑल दैट सिंबॉलिज्म एंड आई हैव अराइव्ड ऑल दैट सिंबॉलिज्म लीड्स टू सम इकोलॉजिकल कंटेंट. दी love for nature and the use of natural resources. मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि रावण represents our present generation all over the world which consumes utmost of the natural resources. मुझे लगता है कि अब जैसे वानरों का वर्णन है, अतिरथी महारथी बताया है, लेकिन उसका उनका वर्णन है नखद अंश्रा युधा, यानी डेमन्स वेर फाइटिंग विद देयर अस्त्र एंड बीज वेर फाइटिंग विद देयर नेल्स एंड बाइट्स.
Thank you very much for your book, which I will read. And yeah, absolutely. I'm attracted by the word that you use, Adbhuta. Yeah, because Adbhuta Ramayana is exactly this, which talks about Ramayana as being a series of symbols and, you know, particular allegorical meanings. So again, I mean, I just always feel that anything that we say about Ramayana now has already been said. You know, somebody's done it. If not 30 years ago, then 300 years ago. If not 300 years ago, then 600 years ago. But thank you very much for your book. I'll take it.
Marathi, I don't know if you read Marathi.
No, I don't, but I know people who do. So there's always somebody to help.
I had a question.
Yes, of course.
I think there are many students of music here. So I just wanted to know, many of us are trained in a system of music which is primarily based on the oral tradition. And so I was wondering whether the portrayal of Sita in the oral tradition is very different from that in the textual tradition. And have you actually come across songs in whichever language, you know, which display this kind of difference?
Yeah, no, absolutely, Anisha. The Sita in the oral tradition, which is also in this case the folk tradition, is very, very different. And as I was saying, there are Telugu songs in which, you know, Rama is mocked, and there are lots of wedding songs which are like, you know, be careful. There's this wonderful song where, about that moment when, you know, Sita is persuading Rama that he should take her to the forest, and the song is all about, like, of course she doesn't want to stay with her mother-in-law. She's got three mothers-in-law. She wants to go with him. You know, so there's a very, down-to-earth, a very mundane and a very personally felt understanding of Sita. And of course, the problem is that the textual tradition is the patriarchal tradition, right? So it's not going to give us a Sita who is subversive, or a Sita that questions. Of course the Desa and the Marga, the two traditions talk to each other, but the more mischievous, the more challenging, the more contested ideas of all of Indian culture will always be outside the textual tradition, outside the classical tradition, which is of course textual. Thank you very much for bringing that up. That's very critical.
I wanted to ask whether Valmiki Ramayana includes this episode where Mandodari is sent by Ravan to Sita to, you know, convince her to come to Ravan.
No, it doesn't. There's one Rakshasi who's sympathetic to Sita. Her name is Trijata, and she's the one who tells her, like, don't worry, that's an illusion, you know. And Indrajit comes, you know, holding the head of Rama and floating above the sky, and she says, Nani, this is Maya, don't. And in a later tradition, actually as early as Kamba Ramayana, Trijata becomes Vibhishana's daughter, and that's why she's good. That is also to me very interesting how, after Valmiki, the Rakshasi women have more and more developed characters, you know, like what did Mandodari say? And of course, there is that other magnificent, you know, other Mandodaris will, what is she thinking? Yeah, this man has brought this woman back, right? He's obviously obsessed with her in some way, so obsessed with her that he won't violate her, he'll wait for her to come. She's been his wife forever, what is she thinking? You know, so that becomes a whole nother set of stories, a whole nother set of imaginations about Mandodari. Then, you know, there's, I don't know if people are reading this guy called Anand Neelakandan, His book is Asura, which is about Ramayana, and he's got this whole complicated thing about Mandodari there being like really cold and sort of actually frigid, and so Ravana cannot stand to be with her, and so he goes looking for these other women, and you know, so that's how these texts grow, because somebody is also always asking a question that needs to be answered, and Ramanujan had this wonderful way of talking about epic. He said, an epic is like a crystal. It grows where there is a flaw, F-L-A-W, right? So if the question is asked, you have to give the answer. And Uttarakhanda is full of that. It's full of, why did Hanuman not know his magical powers? Oh, let me tell you why he didn't know. Why was Ravana not touching Sita? Oh, let me tell you why. Because Rambha cursed him, you know, like that. So
in between all this idea of Maryada Purushottam, can we look up to Ramayana as a sarcasm on patriarchy? And ultimately it brings up woman empowerment. Can we look at it?
I don't think Rama does much for women's empowerment.
No, I'm not trying to say that.
Yeah.
I'm trying to say that ultimately Sita gets she ultimately decides to take her own course in the end. She has she has had enough of all the submissive life right through. So can we look at it in that way?
You know, there are many, many reasons to admire Rama. Yeah, just because I don't think that Maryada Purushottama is an appropriate nomenclature for Rama. There are many other things that I find the terrible thing about Rama is that he always sets out to do the right thing and it always goes wrong. In Mahabharata, people say, it's okay, I'll do the wrong thing. Or they say, oh, I didn't know what the right thing was. Rama knows what is the right thing. He does it as much as he can, but it goes wrong. And that is something, I feel bad for Rama, you know? So it's not like, oh, here comes another feminist saying, you know, Maryada Purushottama, no, patriarchy. No, I mean, there are other ways to look at Rama, and I think they're very important other ways to look at Rama. There are things to admire him for. I mean, the fact that he did do what his father wanted, even though he knew that his father was wrong. He loved his brother. You know, I think he loved his wife very much, but there's a moment where when she's taken away from him, he realizes he has no choice. He has to become the Kshatriya that he didn't want to be to get his wife back. So this is somebody that we must feel sympathy for rather than just reject out of hand as like, well, you know, the Maryada Purushottama thing is not working, so nothing works. Yeah, many things do. There are other ways to approach Rama. And I think also, not simply to see Rama only in terms of Sita, but to see him in terms of the destiny that he's born into, his family, his stepmother, his own mother, who's not a very nice person at all. When I get into something like this, I realize, like, I should just say it the short way, read the text, you know?
So I just had a question. Is there, or has it ever been established if there is a female voice that has contributed to, say, like the any Ramayana? Someone else wants to ask it?
No, it's, somebody else had the same question.
Okay.
There are definitely women's Ramayanas from more recent centuries. Of course, there are lots of modern ones, but interestingly, no woman's story is ever going to call it Ramayana. She calls it Sitayana, she calls it something else. Nobody calls it Ramayana. And it's very difficult to establish a female voice just from the feel of it, you know. I mean, we also want to find women's voices in Rig Veda, among the compositions in the Rig Veda. We want to find women's voices in the Upanishads. We know for sure that there are women's voices in the Sangam poetry from the great Tamil poetry gatherings, right? But they're named as women. We suspect that there are probably four or five women included in in Sanskrit court poetry, in erotic poetry. But per se, I'm not sure that there's a way to say, "Arey, yaar, this sounds like a woman." You know, I don't think we can do it even in languages now. It's very interesting if we were to read our books without covers. You know, would we know that this was written by a man or whether it was written by a woman? I also don't think necessarily that finding a woman's voice would, within the text that already exists, the patriarchal text that already, I don't think it's going to make a difference. You know, but I do think that there are, I know there are women's Ramayanas, and they are, of course, it's a different story. It's not even the Ramayana, so, I mean, it's not called the Ramayana.
My question is totally different. I wanted to know whether there are elements of the matriarchal tradition in some of the things we see. You know, is it, could it possibly be a clash of two traditions?
You know, again, so the new mythologies that are being written in Nilakandan and various other people, they are seeing the great clash as the clash between northern and southern. They're not seeing it as patriarchal versus matriarchal. And to that extent, this is why I think we've always been retelling Ramayana. It's our politics that make us tell the text anew. It's our politics that makes us look for the matriarchy or the Dravida or the this or the that. And so the text, and this is why I say it's such a generous and loving text. It's so responsive. You know, we can find things in it that we're looking for. We can put things in it that we think have been left out. The one indication I think of the matriarchy could be Rishya Shringa's wife is Dasharatha's daughter. Her name is Shanta, and Bhavabhuti makes a big deal of her in Uttara Ramacharita. But it is true in Valmiki also that Rishya Shringa comes and he continues to live in the forest. He continues to live with Dasharatha until Dasharatha gives him a kingdom and sends him away. So I don't know if that's matriarchy or matrilineal or whether, you know, how Dasharatha's single daughter is impacting the larger politics of what's going on. There's also Swayamprabha, who's a very, very strange creature. She lives alone in the forest in this magical cavern. She's a tapaswini. There's no explanation for her at all, but she's the only non-sexualized woman in the whole Ramayana. So that I've always found her very interesting, but I haven't been able to find anything except those 10 verses or 12 verses.
One more addition to the question. Now I'm wondering about whether Sita's attitude reflects a matriarchal.
Yeah, whether Sita's attitude reflects a matriarchal position, it may well.
You know, the fact that she's born
from the earth. But you know, it's also true that very quickly after Valmiki, the next Ramayanas that appear, she's born from the earth, but suddenly she has sisters, then she has a mother. You know, so even that is diluted. I mean, it's just, you cannot have a strong female oppositional counter, not even an opposition.
Thank you for a very, very compassionate rendering representation of Ramayana. In present times, it's so rare that there is compassion and it has to do with Ramayana. But my question is that this golden deer story, which is in a sense the pivotal incident, is there any version of Ramayana in which that story is omitted? Because it is almost like the original sin in the Garden of Eden, because it is Sita.
Very nice, yeah. I can't imagine that you can tell the Ramayana without that story. But I do know that there are Ramayanas where it's very short, it's very brief. It's also almost sort of metonymic. Arey, tumhe to pata hai kya ho raha hai? You know, I don't need to tell you. But what is also very interesting in Valmiki is Sita's response to the deer. When she sees it, she says, "I want it." And Lakshmana was like, I think it's magic. And Rama was like, "Do you really want?" She said, "Yes, I want it." She said, "If you don't bring it back," and she said, "If you bring it alive, I'll keep it as a pet. If you kill it, its meat will be so sweet. And you know what? I really want that golden hide. We'll take it home to Ayodhya and everybody will envy us."
right? So there is something really like jadu. You know, people lose their senses, Rama and Sita in particular, when they see this. And I it is the pivotal incident. I don't think you can tell the story without it. I really don't think you can.
Do you get this, like this sin, which is a...
No, the sin idea is fantastic, yeah. Yeah. Except that I don't think that Hinduism really wraps its head around the idea of sin. There's transgression. You know, we have the word papa in all our Indian languages, but I just really find, because within Hinduism, anything you do can be worked off. You can take 10 baths, or you can, you know, feed 50 Brahmins. You know, it never happens when you feed 100 Dalits, on the other hand, you know. If you feed 50 Brahmins, so, you know, sin and original sin is a state from which you do not recover. Right? And I think that's why I love to think that it's the Garden of Eden moment, and it's a loss of innocence, but I don't know if it's sin is the word that I would use there.
It's not, but you know, it goes against what Sita tells Ram in the first instance, that keep your weapons away, and it is she who is goading him, which I find...
No, she's the one who says, you should get it, even though she's the one who has just said, put down your bows and arrows. Yeah.
I think I get the final question.
Yes.
You've been very patient. Yes, you get the final.
You began your talk by urging us to kind of think about various ways we can recover the text. And in my mind, there are kind of two ways of approaching it. One is acknowledging the plurality of the tradition in the vein of A.K. Ramanujan. The other is kind of creative and less obvious close readings of the text and episodes, which is kind of what you have done. But what I'm wondering is that even that kind of close reading of a text requires a kind of oratext or a kind of formality in organization. So I'm wondering, in your own experience of the Valmiki Ramayana, are there discrepancies between manuscript variations in the Valmiki's text itself, and how would that affect or change maybe one's interpretation of what you presented?
Absolutely, yeah. No, you know, when I did this, I did the Valmiki translation about 5 years after I came out of grad school. Right? So I was really like, no, critical edition, nothing else. It was only look at the critical edition. And the critical edition is a manuscript that consists of all the verses that appear in all the manuscript traditions. And it leaves out more particular, you know, sometimes local variations, sometimes stories that don't appear each and every place. And I've since then really changed my mind. I think that, you know, in trained as I was at the time that I was, in the place that I was, the critical edition was very important. I don't care anymore, whether it's inside the critical edition or it's not. So the idea of the Urtext for me is no longer this edition of Valmiki, but it is Valmiki. And it will always be Valmiki, and I because that's the text that I know best. It's also a text that I enjoy very much because it hasn't been completely bhaktified. Rama is not yet always God, and so he's really interesting. You can ask questions of him, you can demand answers, you know? It's the most open of all the texts that are. Yeah.
Thank you.